Welcome to Hockey Night Live, and we begin a weekend of hockey from the Islanders' new Walk of Fame. They have hung 9 plaques to honor their Hall of Famers, the greats from the Cup years. So the Islanders of today will get plenty of inspiration when they walk past these faces and make their way out onto the ice. But today, no extra motivation necessary. It's the Flyers, a team ahead of them in the standings, and it's a 4-point game next. Butch Goring has all of his buddies here with him this weekend. It's the core of four tomorrow. We're putting Butch to work, but some of the guys who will be honored tomorrow are out at center ice, and they're going to be part of today's ceremonial puck drop. Howie?
All right, Deb, thanks. And we are going to show you those who are in attendance to take part in these ceremonies as Rick DiPietro gets
set
to
fan appreciation day.
Become a spectator for a couple of minutes.
Weekend.
Let's go down and join
Please
PA announcer Roger
center
Luce.
Ice. For this afternoon's ceremonial face-off, joining Flyers captain Jason Smith and Islanders captain Bill Guerin is Pam Bjalken, season ticket holder with her father since 1972 in section 327, row A. Pam recently submitted a letter to the Islanders proclaiming herself the biggest Islander fan on Long Island. And now, fans, joining Pam are three of the men largely responsible for the Islanders' 4 Stanley Cups. Will you please welcome first Islander legend Bill Torrey. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Al Arbour. Ladies and gentlemen, Bobby Nystrom.
Pat is a season ticket holder. She could just as easily have given that puck to Guerin rather than the way she dropped it. But anyway, Nystrom, Torrey, Arbour, three of the many who will be honored tomorrow. The core of the four represents 16 players who played on all 4 Cup winners. But don't forget, Al Arbour was the coach, Bill Torrey the general manager. Lorne Henning was a player as well as an assistant coach on any of the 4 teams. And Ted Nolan, with that great gesture early in the year, set Al's return back in place for his 1,500th game coach.
We are back on our Hockey Night Live intermission report presented by GEICO. Mike Bossy is our special guest at the intermission. His new plaque, Hall of Fame plaque, says the greatest pure goal scorer. So glad to have you with us this weekend. What'd you think of the first period of the game so far? Kind of your pace.
Well, the pace was kind of feeling each other out for the first period. It's a huge game for both teams, so you can only imagine that no one wants to make that mistake that's going to lead to the goal that's going to ruin their chances of winning. So I expect it to open up maybe a little more in the next couple of periods.
So we heard you guys had a nice steak dinner last night. I want to know who, when you guys all get together, tells the best stories.
Well, last night was kind of special because we had a table of 5 guys sitting together. We rotated all the guys in and out of that room, and we were taping a DVD that's going to come out in the next couple of months. So all the stories were told, the same old stories that we tell every time we see each other. But my favorite is always the Al Arbour story when we went to Las Vegas for like a 2-day rest in between a road trip at one point. And we were in the morning, we were going to breakfast, Brian and I were, and we saw Al traipsing through the hotel with his shorts, a t-shirt, a towel over his shoulder, and a book and reading glasses. And we looked at Al and said, Al, where are you going? He says, I'm going out to the pool. I said, but Al, it's 32 degrees outside and there's no water in the pool. What are you doing? So stories like that were told last night.
That's what you get for going to Las Vegas to rest, okay? That's Absolutely. All I'm going to say. We look forward to seeing you tomorrow in the big celebration.
Thank you.
All right. Mike Bossy and the Islanders are here for the 25th anniversary of the last Stanley Cup. We'll celebrate the Cora Four tomorrow. Back after this.
In 79-80, the guy they called Dog was a rookie. And a few months later, he was a cup winner, Duane Sutter.
Yeah, we're in the doghouse over here. 25 years later, how do you feel about the four cups? Have things changed about how you feel about it when you look back on it now?
Well, the first one, a guy was pretty young and naive. And then when they came every year, you took it for granted. It might happen forever. But it's always a huge thrill to come back, see the fans, and tell some old stories with the teammates.
How about the Islanders of today with a couple of brothers coaching and being general managers? I know you watch a lot and still working in the game of Florida.
Right. I enjoy working with it. I like the interaction with our young draft picks and the direction that we're heading down there in Florida.
All right. Well, we'll see them on Sunday. Yes. Just in time for you.
Yes, that's great.
All right, guys.
This is Bob Bourne with a hard pass slash shot. Sutter grabbed it.
Imagine a Sutter in front of the net. Imagine that.
One of the many faces of Butch Goring. There you go.
Holy smokes.
Where is that helmet?
it's hidden. it's a classic there.
This is my favorite look. It's like the mountain man.
I know. That just, those are the good old days.
Back after this.
Van Gundy, Mike Breen.
It started with Bobby Nystrom's overtime goal in Game 6 against the Flyers, and the Islanders were on their way against Minnesota. And then 1982 was survival, first against Pittsburgh and then Vancouver. And a four-game sweep against Wayne Gretzky and the Edmonton Oilers cemented the Islanders as a true dynasty. They walked as champions then, they walked as champions today. In a tradition that was started 2 years ago when the Islanders celebrated the first Stanley Cup, season ticket holders were invited to carry the numbers of the greats, and the architect Bill Torrey and the head coach also walked across from the team hotel to the Nassau Coliseum, where this group of Islanders will likely for the last time be honored as four-time Stanley Cup champions. Hi there, and welcome to the Islanders celebration of the core of the four and the 25th anniversary of that fourth Stanley Cup. What an accomplishment it is to win just one cup. The grind of a regular season, four playoff series, the Stanley Cup Finals. But to keep the group together and win it four times is an astounding accomplishment that may never be duplicated. So all the men that were a part of all four of the Islanders Stanley Cup teams will be honored today, from the trainer and the equipment manager to the 16 players, even an assistant coach who played that first year, and Al Arbour, the head coach, and the architect, Bill Torrey. So to get you in the mood, if you're not already there, we begin our coverage today with the story of the four cups. They were a collection of players perhaps unlike any who came before them or who've come along since. Some were blessed with singularly spectacular talents, skills that would someday enable them to add the adjective Hall of Famer to their resumes. Others combined a lethal blend of skill and toughness that would earn them entrance into that same hallowed hall. Behind the bench was their leader, a man with a maestro's touch for getting the most out of his men, who taught them all that from the top of the roster to the bottom, the secret to the game was always hard work and determination. Their unwavering work ethic, grit, and intensity marked them as a group that was almost impossible to play against, a group whose collective heart never took a game off. What made them so devastating was that on any given day, anyone could be the difference maker, as Kenny Morrow was against Los Angeles. Against the Boston Bruins, they proved once and for all that not only could they play any style of game you wanted to play, they would beat you at that style. Overtime was their time. The more the game wore on, the more they wore down their opponents with a grinding style that forced the opposition into mistakes that were quickly converted into game winners. A double overtime victory over the Buffalo Sabres came at the hands of Bobby Nystrom and foreshadowed future heroics. Eventual Conn Smythe winner Brian Trottier helped lead them to a 3-2 lead over the Philadelphia Flyers in the finals. And then in overtime of Game 6, the goal that no Islander fan would ever forget.
4-4 tie, 7 minutes gone in overtime. Henning. Pass right on the stick of Tonelli. Coming in with Nystrom. Tonelli to Nystrom. He scores! Bob Nystrom scores the goal. The Islanders win the Stanley Cup.
The following year brought a quarterfinal showdown with a young superstar, but his Edmonton Oilers went down to the defending champs in 6 games. Next up were the rival New York Rangers, but the juggernaut was at full speed, and a sweep was at hand for the Islanders. Conn Smythe winner Butch Goring asserted his will over the Minnesota North Stars in the finals, and the Cup stayed home on Long Island. '82 brought the biggest scare to the Islanders' dynasty in the form of a near first-round upset by the Pittsburgh Penguins. This time, it was John Tonelli's turn to play the hero, with a game-tying goal in the waning moments of regulation. And a vintage Tonelli effort on the game winner in overtime. Mike Bossy made the finals against Vancouver his own personal showcase, with goals that were miraculous and some that were just typical Bossy sniper shots, as the Isles swept Vancouver for cup number 3. The trail to the fourth cup would pit the Isles against the Edmonton Oilers in the finals. Nystrom and Tonelli proved that they hadn't lost their lethal touch. Bossy continued to set goal-scoring marks with 17 playoff goals. And Billy Smith shut down the vaunted Oilers offense to win the Conn Smythe. When it was all over, 16 players had shared the experience of 16 straight playoff series victories and an improbable 4 straight Stanley Cups. 16 men with one guiding hand had persevered through everything their opponents had thrown at them and arrived at a moment in hockey history that is unlikely ever to be repeated again.
And I think what Deb Kaufman said was exactly right. It's just about impossible to imagine that ever being duplicated. 19 straight series wins, combining for the 4 Stanley Cups, and then losing in the Stanley Cup final in 1984 against the Edmonton Oilers. Hi, and welcome to our special coverage. Howie Rose, Billy Jaffe. You've seen Deb. Butch Goring is going to be a part of everything this afternoon, both on the ice before the game and between periods with us as well. It's a very, very special day, and Billy, when you think of the 19 straight series wins, you have to appreciate the fact that so much of that team came up through the organization.
And that's the way you have to build a team. It was then, and that's the way you have to do it right now. An incredibly special run. I remember watching them in Chicago. So much respect for that organization when they were on the run.
And who better to emcee the core of the four but Jiggs McDonald?
Those years, I should say, they didn't have a number on their back. They were the first guys here in the morning, the last guys to leave in the evening. And both of these gentlemen have been inducted into the respective halls of fame for athletic trainers and equipment managers. They were the best in the business. The athletic trainer, Ron Waske, and the equipment manager, Jimmy Pickard. Several of the players in the core of four were drafted and signed on the advice of one man. Longtime scout, he'd played in the National Hockey League and then came to work for the New York Islanders and found so many of these guys who were prospects at the time but went on to be members of the Corps of the Four. Ladies and gentlemen, Earl Ingerfield. And now I'd like to introduce some players. You know them probably better than I do. You can find their names and their numbers in the rafters here at the Nassau Coliseum. Please welcome the man who started it all at 7-11 of overtime, May 24th, 1980, Mr. New York Islander, number 23, Bobby Nystrom. This next player was the premier power forward of his generation. Hockey Hall of Famer, number 9, Jethro Clark Gillies. This next player, you could say, was a pure goal scorer. He had 9 straight seasons of 50 or more goals, 573 in all. The Islanders' all-time leading goal scorer, Hockey Hall of Famer, number 22, Mike Bossy. He is the owner of 6 100-point seasons as a New York Islander, netted 500 goals himself, and his 1,123 points makes him the all-time leading scorer in the Islanders' history books, Hockey Hall of Famer number 19, Brian Trotche. And you all know this player. 3-time Norris Trophy winner. He could upend an opponent here at center ice, had a knack for scoring too, but we know him best by this one word, this title, captain. Hockey Hall of Famer, number 5, Denny Potvin.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It takes more than 3 or 4 players to be successful in professional sports. It takes more than individual success to become champions. It takes the dedication, focus, and determination of a group to become the best. This is the moment to shine the light on the individuals who were the heart, grit, and character of 4 consecutive Stanley Cup champion teams. Let the introduction begin of the individuals that are my teammates for life. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here. Just to continue on the theme that Boss has so eloquently opened for us, we had a great team, we have a great family, even now in this a little older New York Islander hockey team. I have the great pleasure of introducing a defenseman that joined us in 1979-80. As you know, it was a time where we needed some strength. We needed some determination. He first came to training camp. Dave Langevin was a man mountain. I decided that I was going to try and give him a hip check at training camp. He never moved, and I came out with a bruise. Please welcome our defense partner, Dave Langevin. Well, I tell you what, on the same theme, another defenseman, a little different than Dave, but it was his partner. Stefan Pearson, in my view, was one of the strongest players that we have played with throughout our career, and I'll tell you why. There was a playoff series in the early 80s where Stefan had a broken jaw. He went out and played every game in that series. His teeth were wired, he could only eat through a straw, never missed a shift, never missed a game, and you often saw him as my partner on the power play, one of the great, great competitors of our great team, Stefan Pearson.
Hello there, Islander fans. Thank you again for all your support. It's great to be back in the building. The next player played six seasons for the New York Islanders. He was the ultimate teammate. He was tough and he was gritty. And he would protect teammates from any and all opponents. He made it impossible for the other players to stand in front of our net. He would hit you, he would hack you, or else he'd run over you. And he added a dimension to our team that was sorely needed after our playoff losses in 78 and 79. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome number six, number 24, Gord Laid. The next player played 10 seasons for the New York Islanders. Not only did he have a great career with the Islanders, but he also is one of the few hockey players to win an Olympic gold medal and the Stanley Cup the same year. I thought maybe you'd figure out already. He won the gold medal with the 19 USA Miracle on Ice team and then went on to win four Stanley Cups. Even though he wasn't known for his offense, he came through in the clutch and scored three overtime game-winning goals in the playoffs. Who can forget the one against the Rangers? Please welcome number six, Ken Morrow. The next player played 6 seasons for the New York Islanders. He had all the skills. He was incredibly fast and had great moves. He was a member of the fastest line in the league, the potent KGB line with Bob Bourne and Butch Goring. His offensive skills helped him score 22 goals and 36 goals in his first two NHL seasons. He was also a penalty-killing specialist and still is the Islanders' all-time leader in shorthanded goals. Let's give a New York welcome to number 28, Anders Keller.
Introduce to you, I think most of you remember his dash from one end of the rink to the other, slipping the puck through Barry Beck's legs and scoring against the Rangers back in, oh God knows when, that was a long time ago. A great friend of mine and I believe part of one of the greatest left sides a hockey team has ever had, number 14, Bobby Bourne. This next fellow came to us as a rookie in 1979-80. Only won 4 cups in his first 4 years in the league, which wasn't too bad. We nicknamed him Dog, and I think the biggest reasons we named him Dog was because he was such an agitator, always nipping at your heels. Every team in the league hated him, but we loved to have him on our side. A great part of our core of four Stanley Cup winners. Number 12, Duane Sutter.
And finally, he was small in stature, but relentless in effort. Our last teammate was the tireless worker, the man for every situation, and the last piece of the puzzle that made us who we are. We all remember him for his helmet, and we'll never forget the player. Number 91, Butch Goring.
This next guy was loved and respected by all of us, not only for his insightfulness, but also for his solid two-way play each and every game. He started the play to our first of 4 championships, Henning to Tonelli to Nystrom, and continues as one of the best people in the business today, our ever-popular teammate number 10, Lorne Henning. This next guy, each and every game, he brought a determination and intensity that inspired all of us. We as teammates appreciated all his big goals, his big assists, and tireless work ethic. A champion in all aspects of life, our friend and teammate always, number 27, John Tonelli.
I'd be very remiss if I didn't remind you there was a number 11, Wayne Merrick, who is not able to be with us today because of a prior commitment, and also number 31, Billy Smith, who last night played his third game, I think, in five nights. He wouldn't have done that for the Islanders. He wouldn't have done that in the NHL, but with the legends of hockey, he plays three in five nights now. We had such a great support staff, folks. People like Joanne Holloway, Ralph Saletti, Roberto back here, who has made ice for years after years. We couldn't have done it without him or without you. And before you win a Stanley Cup, before you even win a playoff game, or get through a long hockey season, grueling season, or just get 20 guys that want to go through the wall for you and are willing to do whatever it takes to win, someone has to build that team. One you know is the architect, the other you know is the coach. Please welcome Bill Torrey and number 1500, Al Arbour. As I had the privilege of announcing this past Friday, this extraordinary Core of the Four event is just the first alumni weekend the New York Islanders will host annually, where all Islanders alumni will be welcomed back home. When you have a history as rich, and I might add a future as bright, as this New York Islander franchise, you always take time with your fans to remember. When we say we are all Islanders, that truly means everyone. Ladies and gentlemen, these gentlemen here are your New York Islanders Core of the Four.
So what you're seeing now are the Core of the Four surrounding the Stanley Cup and lining up in tribute, just out of your picture now, but to the right of how you look at it, the current day Islanders who are wearing jerseys that in some way correspond roughly to specific members of this Core of the Four. Mike Comrie and Radek Martinek, and let's see, that's Bruno Gervais wearing Dave Langevin's number. And Bill Guerin, of course, with the Captain C, representing Dennis Potvin. And you even notice that patch on the left sleeve. That's what they wore in 1980. That was the Winter Olympics patch from Lake Placid. And certainly Ken Morrow knows that rather well, having won a gold medal there and then the Stanley Cup on the 24th of May, 1980 here. And Billy, you know, Jiggs was very gracious in mentioning a lot of the support staff and a lot of the people who are part of the organization who helped create what became the Islander dynasty. There's one man, in my opinion, who didn't qualify as one of the core of the four, at least not in a technical sense, because he left the Islanders in the summer of 1982 to become the general manager of the Detroit Red Wings before the Islanders would win their fourth consecutive cup. But in many people's opinion, one of the real brains of that outfit was Jim Devolano, who was the chief scout of the Islanders and drafted so many of the people you just saw on the ice who would go on to win four straight Stanley Cups. It was just about the perfectly built expansion team.
And Jimmy Devolano, even though there were some lean years in the Motor City early in the mid-80s and late 80s, he helped redevelop that team as well, eventually getting some great guys. So a wonderful track record that he's had, and definitely a main key to this organization's success in the early 1980s. What great little ceremony here. And just seeing those guys smile, all of them coming out. Once you're a teammate, Howie, in any sport, you're always a teammate. You know, you might not love everybody, but when you go through what they did as a team, you end up learning to respect. And sometimes that is even bigger and better. It's just a wonderful thing to be a teammate, watching these guys hug each other and smile.
Players who have won championships will tell you that when you win a cup or a championship in whatever sport, you are bonded with your teammates forever. And today is a perfect example of that. The ultimate bonding experience came right here. 7-11 of overtime, May 24th, 1980. Bob Nystrom with the overtime goal. The Islanders won their first Stanley Cup. A whole lot more straight ahead.
This week, the Islanders hung up 9 plaques on the Wall of Fame, which soon will go into a Hall of Fame to honor their Islander greats. Bob Nystrom, Mr. Islander, has his own plaque now on the wall. Welcome back. This is the 25th anniversary of the last of the four Stanley Cups, which means it's been almost 30 years since the first Stanley Cup. It is hard to believe that one goal changed the course of this Islander franchise, but indeed, one goal changed the course of hockey history.
I dreamt about it and thought about it a lot. I mean, even to this, from the standpoint of being a hero, you know, like being a police officer or a fireman or saving somebody. I mean, I always wanted to be a hero. So when you're put in that situation, you know, it's a thrill of a lifetime.
Check by Goring. Gillies jumped it in. 4 seconds. It's going to be overtime. The tension will continue until one goal decides this one.
We were pretty down. I mean, we really were down after the third period because we were congratulating each other after the second. I personally went back into the stick room. I always used to sit in there. And, you know, the funny thing was I went and borrowed a scalpel. And I tell the story, people think I'm crazy, but I was just sitting in there just kind of biding the time, you know, like it's very tough to just sit, you know, and just wait. So I was in there and I was actually carving a chunk out of my stick. And I said, you know, this is going to be my winning goal. I'm going to win this, you know. And I'm sure that everyone else thought the same thing because that's kind of the attitude that we have. And then I heard in the locker room, who's going to be the hero? And that was another thing that always happened. Who's going to be the guy that's going to win it? And everyone would chime in, hey, I'm going to win it. I'm going to win it. I'm going to win it. You know, we believed that we were going to win. And you know what? We always had a saying, hell bent for leather. Let's go at him. Let's get this over with. Slowed down, you know, because, well, maybe it didn't slow down, it's just that I thought of so many things before the puck even came to me as to what I was going to do with it.
Tonelli, the Nystrom!
Oh, man, the thought went through my head. Thank God I didn't deke, you know, I probably would have lost it.
He scored!
When I saw it deflect and I saw that it was going up high, it seemed like Peters was a little bit slow to react. I think he thought Johnny T might was maybe going to shoot. And I could watch it, and I saw it. I said, this definitely is going to go over him. And I knew that it was going in. As soon as the puck went in, I heard, and in looking at photographs after the fact, you could see the fans behind the net where the camera angle was, where they were kind of up, up, and then they were up. And then I could just hear them pounding on the glass. And that's one of the beautiful things about overtime is that when the puck goes in the net, it's done. They can't come back, you know, the game is over. And that was my feeling at that time. And then, you know, the exhilaration when I saw the boys coming and to congratulate me then, it was, you know, exhilaration and happiness. And man, we got this monkey off our back.
Tonelli to Nystrom, he scored!
It allowed me to give my teammates something that they always wanted, you know. And believe me, I always consider myself a journeyman player and a, you know, blue collar, hard working, and I rode their coattails a lot. And it was an opportunity for me to give them a goal that brought the Stanley Cup. And I've heard a million things about where people were when I scored that goal. So, I mean, it just changed my life that way. People remember me here, probably more so than a lot of other players. And for that, I'm very thankful.
You play your game in the regular season, you make your name in the postseason, and Bobby Nystrom will be remembered forever for the overtime goal that won the Islanders their first Stanley Cup. Jeremy Colliton has the honor of wearing Bobby Nystrom's jersey in the warm-ups, so what a thrill for him. When we come back, you will be thrilled by the storytelling of these three Islanders, Jiggs McDonald with Bob Bourne, Clark Gillies, and Butch Goring. They'll tell some old stories that may have gotten longer by the years when we come back.
Welcome back to the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum. Not an ounce of makeup on any of them. They walked a little slower in the red carpet today in a couple of cases, although not Mike Bossy. There's number 19, Brian Trache, waving to the crowd here. Capacity crowd on hand, and of course, the captain. And Lord Stanley, another visit to Long Island. I'm Jiggs McDonald. Welcome to our studio here at the Nassau Coliseum. Three of the members of the core of the four have joined me. You know Butch Goring, of course, from Islander telecasts on a regular basis. You also know Clark Gillies, I'm sure, and all the way from Kelowna, B.C. to be with us today, number 14, Bobby Bourne. Friday night, a bunch of us got together and we were just talking, and that's what we're going to do today. You were thrown under the bus, Mr. Gillies. Didn't get a chance to defend yourself. We were asking, what happened to the cup? After it was won, it's carried off the ice, dressing room. Where did it go that night?
Well,
the boys
it went a lot of places. It was in the back of somebody's trunk, at the back of the seat, top of the car, I think. It ended up at my house. Ended up at my house, and I think around the story I think you're getting at is about 5 o'clock in the morning.
No, I'm not going to eat. But that, now that you mentioned it.
Thinking about going to sleep, and my dog was looking at me with kind of a, I had a big black German Shepherd, and he was looking at me kind of forlorn, and I said, you know, I know what'll make him happy. So I took out a thing of gravy, of kennel ration, I put it in the top of the cup and let him eat out of the cup. So that was one of the things. And then I don't know where it went after that, but it got bounced around pretty good.
Yeah, it sure did. And as everybody has said, the catalyst, the guy who came, Bobby, to put this whole thing together. And there was some reaction when the trade was made with Los Angeles. They thought the Islanders were trying to get younger, not older, and they brought in Butchie.
I know. It's a story we still can't figure out, but it worked out pretty good, Jiggsy.
Yeah, it did. Now, you guys are too young. You would have never seen him play junior out west, right?
No, I never.
Yeah. And Jiggs, I have to tell you, though, you know, when I first was traded over here, you know, Bob Bourne's best friend at the time was Dave Lewis, so I wasn't received with open arms here. Bourne was a little upset for a while until he realized I didn't mind having a beer with him, and then it was okay.
You sent me in my first breakaway,
exactly.
Which I missed.
He sent you in on a breakaway?
Yes, he did. The odd time.
He passed the puck?
He did, yes.
Yeah, I had more assists than goals, Jiggs, you know.
I know. What?
I had. I'll tell you one story. When Butchie first came to the team, and Al put him with Duane Sutter and I, and I went over to Butch, and I said, you know, you see Dog sitting in the other room? I said, yeah. And I said, listen to me. I said, when you go on the ice from now on, I said, I don't know what happened out in L.A., I said, but when you come here and you go on the ice, he said, you don't have to worry about anything. You just make sure that you make Dog and I look good, and you know, I'll take care of the rest of it. And Butchie said, I think I'm going to like playing here. I think I like that. Yeah.
Well, I think each of you made him look pretty good a couple of times, too.
Well, we had a great line with Anders Keller and I and Butch, and had a lot of fun. And I always said, to tell you what, I love playing with Brian Trotsky, but I always said that Butch Goring was the best suited center iceman I ever had, because he would send me in and breakaway after breakaway.
Look what happens here.
A little good to do, but yeah. And guess who gets the puck here?
Yeah.
He gives it to Butch.
Yeah.
That was a great pass, Barney, you know.
Well, you're yelling from the blue line, Butch.
I'm open. Get me in the puck.
I could hear you coming.
I'm surprised Butch was able to raise
it. You see me run that guy over?
Oh, yeah,
that?
You're trying to get all the
Nobody
way.
Nobody talks about the hitting that I used to play on. Oh, here's the big guy here. Nice elbow, Clark. That was a surprise.
Oh, here he goes.
That's my favorite place, the front of the net.
I wonder who won the Conn Smythe. He got all those goals because of us.
That's right.
I took all the glory.
Was any one of the four Stanley Cups more special than any other?
Obviously the second one was more important for me, and everybody thinks it's because I won the Conn Smythe that year, but it's not true. When I joined this club, I didn't really know anybody, and it takes a while to get familiar with your teammates and to have some laughs and some fun, and so a lot of those things happened in the second year, so the second year was really good for me.
I think obviously the first year, every time you win, the first time is awesome. But for me, the fourth time, I led the team in scoring that year. It was really special. I played with the Dumb Brothers. And,
and those of you who don't know who that is, that's the Sutter Brothers.
You just figure that out.
The Sutter Brothers.
But also, we played a team that was supposed to be the team that was going to knock us off, and we beat them 4 straight with the Oilers.
Yeah, and number 99 didn't even get a point, recall.
Yeah.
Wayne Gretzky.
Yeah.
Yeah, the guys were talking about that. And that speaks for itself, really.
Yeah.
Of the guys here today, the core of the four, there are some guys who were here for 3 Stanley Cups, some guys who were here for 2. Anyone that you really wish was here like this for all 4?
For me, is Thomas Johnson. I love Tommy John, and just he could have played all 4 years on our team. He could have played forever, and he's the guy I wish was here.
Clarky?
Well, I think certainly Tommy was a great teammate of ours. I would have to maybe look at Brent Sutter. I think added a lot to our team to help us win the last 2. I wish Smitty could be here. I think the fans would have loved to have seen Smitty here. Wayne Merrick, the guys that were on those 4 teams. But it's just nice to see everybody. I can't believe the way we presented ourselves for all that time that we're all still around. That's the most amazing thing.
Are you referring to traffic, of course, and the possibility of a collision on the Long Island Expressway?
Crossing the wall,
or crossing the street late at night. Alan and Bill, there've got to be some stories about Mr. Arbour, Mr. Torrey, that you may want to share with us, boys.
I have one that I like. And
I was afraid of that one.
Bill was a different kind of GM, I think, and doesn't get enough credit for he comes off as a stern guy and someone who has no sense of humor. And actually he does, and these guys will laugh because they were around for all of Dennis Potvin's, initial years. But the one I laugh at is a Christmas party, and Dennis hadn't been playing all that well, and a lot of turnovers on his own end. And we had a Christmas party, and Bill Torrey called up Dennis and said, Dennis, I know you've been really struggling. He says, here's some cough medicine. Maybe you'll stop coughing up the puck. So only a GM could do that, and only Dennis could take that. I mean, that was, I think, the camaraderie and the spirit of the hockey club.
Stefan Persson told a story the other night about Al having some biscuits, something in the dressing room he thought was like a brownie, and it turned out to be a dog biscuit because we were playing like dogs.
There's lots of stories about
that.
The egg story.
Yeah, the egg story where he had put an egg in each one of our lockers, and he said, he came in and everybody says, what is the egg in my locker for? And he said, well, I bet the way you guys played last night, he said, if you put those eggs in your pants tomorrow night, he said, I'll bet you come in here after the game and none of them will be broken. Well, with that, Pat Price took the egg out of his locker, went up, and smashed it on top of Al's head, which Al didn't think was very funny. And Pricey was gone about 2 weeks later, I believe.
Borny already knew that Al didn't have a sense of humor.
Oh,
right?
Man.
What did you do to him?
Oh, there's lots of stories, but the couple of the ones I remember the best is, you know, when you go out to practice, we're always given a different colored vest or a jersey to play on a certain line with, and I bounced around from line to line. I mean, Butchie and I played together for quite a while, but I was getting frustrated one year, and we were up in Edmonton, and so I told Jimmy Pickard to make up a vest with the four different colors on it. And so I come out on the ice, and Al sees me, and we're skating around just before practice, and there's dead silence up there, and he comes up to me, and he whispers in my ear, he says, "Get off the ice." And I says, "Al, come on." He says, "Get off the ice." But Al was great because another Edmonton story was my brother used to go up there all the time, and he'd always bring a 40-pounder of rum and
40-ouncer.
Yeah, 40-ouncer.
Uninitiated, yeah.
And I got on the ice, and we were up all night, and I got on the ice. We had an early practice, and Al came up to me again, and he goes, "Hey, Borny," he says, "you're not feeling very well." And I says, "No, Al, I feel great. I was trying to say you feel great." And he goes, "No, you don't feel very well. Get off the ice."
Nobody here ever broke curfew or had the misfortune of running into Al in the lobby maybe 5 minutes after 11 or...
The one time.
Well, did you?
Oh, yes. We remember that Clarky. We
no, you don't remember, do you?
Oh, yes, you were.
I wasn't with you.
You were by yourself.
No, my last
don't
year.
Don't throw me under the bus.
You'll remember the story. My last year, and Clarky's too.
That's probably why it was your last year.
We were in St. Louis in the Marriott there. There's a bar at the top of the hotel. And so, and Clarky and I and Bobby weren't dressing the next night. And we all says, no, this ain't going to happen. So around 11:30 at night, we all meet in the lobby, go up to the hotel, and we drew straws to see who was going to look in the bar. The bar was off to the left.
I do remember that.
And so the elevator the elevator opens up, and I look around, and Al's sitting right in the corner of the bar. And I look at him, he goes... So I walk over and he says, "Where's your buddies?" And I said, "Oh, they're probably in the rooms." He says, "Borny, go get your buddies off the elevator." And so I go to the elevator, pull the guys off, and it was one of the nights where Al bought us some beers. It was an unbelievable night with Al.
I don't mean to be real serious, but I'm just, in your minds, can something like you guys accomplished be done again in today's game with free agency and salary cap, everything else?
I don't think so. I mean, you look at what's happened as far as player movement over the last few years, the last 5, 6, 10 years. You have success, you win a cup, and then if you're anywhere close to being a free agent, they tend to go for the highest dollar to another team. So it's to keep what we had together for 4 years would probably cost you about $100 million or $150 million to keep it together based on today's price.
You know what the payroll was? 1980s team, the team that won the first Stanley Cup. Bill Torrey told a story this morning at a breakfast thing that we were attending. $9 million was his total payroll, folks. And it went to $13 million. By the time they'd won the fourth, it had gone to $13 million. There are guys in the league making $9 million for a season, right?
And that probably was only for most of two guys that were getting all the money.
On that particular team? I got to thank. This has been wonderful. Butch Goring, Clark Gillies, Bobby Bourne. Thank Memories you, of the core of the forward. And the Islanders pregame will continue with much more right after we pause for these breaks and then come back to the Nassau Veterans Memorial Coliseum.
We are back as the Islanders celebrate the core of the four and the 25th anniversary of the fourth Stanley Cup. Number 27, John Tonelli, was a big part of the core of the four and the goals that you're always remembered for from that Pittsburgh series, the game-tying goal in regulation and the overtime game winner. How much are you asked about that goal, or have you been over the years?
Every so often I get asked about it, and it just brings back great memories. That game, we were in a little bit of trouble, and we were lucky to pull it off. We didn't ever think for 1 minute that we couldn't pull it off, so... probably helped us a lot.
Where did that belief come from that you could pull it off?
I don't know. I just think at certain times during certain situations, every one of us in the dressing room had that timing or that thought that, you know, we got to pull through. And if you notice throughout those four cups, 20 plus players pulled through at a certain time, you know, and it just was somebody. And luckily for me, it was that time for me.
Does it feel like it was 25, 30 years ago?
Not at all. Not today. Seeing these guys that I haven't seen in about a year, it's very special. It gives me a good feeling to see them and say hello and see those smiling faces.
All right, I'll ask you a couple questions about your teammates. We would not have won four Stanley Cups without...
Billy Smith. Billy was just Mr. Wall, you know, set up the wall, and you knew, you know, certain times in a game, you know, they got a breakaway. And I remember specifically that game, that Pittsburgh game, where Mike Bullard came down on a breakaway, and Billy made a save just enough, and it hit the goalpost. I mean, it could have been all over for us. I'll never forget that save he made.
And of the comebacks that you made, the one against Pittsburgh sticks out, but I think people forget that you guys lost in 78 and 79, so the success may be sweeter because you had lost a couple?
You know, it's a learning experience. I mean, it was so devastating for us to lose in 78, 79. We learned a lot from it. You know, I often hear some of the Oilers, you know, when we beat them in our fourth Stanley Cup, all I could hear in the summertime was how much they had learned from watching us win. And help them to win. So, losing the big one, certainly, you can take it two ways. You know, you can learn from it or fade away. And we learned from it and came back stronger.
And took it the best way. Thanks for some time today. Enjoy the rest of your day.
You're welcome. Take care.
Right. From John Tonelli, number 27, back inside to Jiggs McDonald.
All right, Deb. Butch Goring is with us, along with Duane Sutter and Lorne Henning. And the thought has just gone through my mind, Butchie. There had to be an influence from Al, because each of you, at one time or another, has been a head coach in the National Hockey League. Did you use the Al Arbour book?
Well, I don't know if that's a good influence, but you know what? We all enjoy the game, and I think when you have a good, positive experience, Jiggs, you know, such as we did, and you watch what Al did, you know, you take that with you, and it just makes the game a little bit more enjoyable. But I must, and you know, talking about Al, you know, with his methods of coaching and stuff like that, and this was the year I won the Conn Smythe, so he's going to take a lot of credit for me winning the Conn Smythe that particular year. But around January, I had a string going of about maybe 350 games where I hadn't missed a game. And Lorne will recall this. And I came to the rink, and all of a sudden my jersey wasn't there. And it wasn't hanging up. And that's the way you found out whether you were going to play or not. And I'll tell you what, I was steaming mad. And I looked for Al all over the building.
He
I
never
could not find
that to you?
No, oh, no, no.
That was because the night before, you and Anders, when they were doing the wave around behind us, you and Anders Kler were standing up at the end of the bench.
Oh,
that was hilarious.
Well, that could have been. I don't know. Who knows? But I was mad as heck at him. But as he later tells you, that he wanted to motivate the hockey club because he felt the hockey club wasn't playing well. And he thought, if he benched me, it might have a real solid effect on the hockey club. I know one thing. It got me going, because I played pretty good the rest of the year.
Lorne, you becoming an assistant with Al, how did that happen?
Well, Al and I, a lot of history there, because we never really talked a lot. I never played a lot. And then I remember one game I didn't dress, and they scored two power play goals against us, and I spouted off in the paper, and Al made a big joke about it, called me seagull in practice, and he took me in the back room. He said, if I ever open my mouth again, I'll be so far in the minors they'll never find me. So I never expected to be assistant coach, but we just seemed to hit it off. And
That comes to mind again. There was never any controversy around this team, and you got a guy in the middle here, you know.
The worst yapper ever.
Yeah.
I could get away with it because I had that big center iceman playing beside me. Good defense.
A lot of toughness there, Jiggs.
You know, you get a chance now to defend yourself. Bobby Bourne was just hitting where Lorne was and said, yeah, you know, at that time I was playing with the Dumb Brothers. And we all looked at one another and said, who's he talking about? We're playing with the Dumb Brothers.
And he was talking about the Edmonton series when you guys were probably the best line that we had in the finals year.
That's right. Hey,
so what are you going to defend yourself now?
If we weren't playing with Bourne, we would have won the scoring race in playoffs that year and probably shared the Conn Smythe, but Bourne kind of took us down to a lower level.
See, he's out here to defend himself. I understand you want to get even with a couple of guys for things that were said Friday night when we sat around and talked like this?
Mostly you, Jiggs. Like, I thought you really did a good job stirring it up.
Yeah, but I was on your side. I never threw you under the bus, Duane. Not the way some of your teammates have.
They all threw me under the bus. But you know what? I love every one of these guys, and that's why we were around for 4 years, because we were a close group.
You were the kid, right? You were the young guy on that hockey team.
Yeah, 18 years old.
Yeah. Who took you under their wings?
Well, my first roommate, the day I got called up to Edmonton, my first roommate sitting right here on my right.
Really?
That was probably a challenge, Lorne.
Showed me how to get to the rink, and after that, you know, we had a lot of guys from the West that really hung together a lot when Butch came on, and Borny, Clarky, and I, Trotch, you know, we were, as I said earlier, a very close group, and pretty much every one of them offered something.
Favorite Stanley Cup win before we go? Anyone in particular?
Well, I'd have to go with the last one, I guess, against Flyers, for me, anyway. And then after the game, we were kind of hanging on, actually, and I'm not so sure the seventh game, we certainly didn't want to go to Philadelphia. So.
Well, of course, they're an offside goal there, but we're not going to go there, are we, Doug?
No, we're not going there, that's for
sure. You were involved. How far
probably
offside was that goal?
Never was, Doug. Wasn't offside. Wasn't offside, Doug.
The best sign the following year in exhibition, going to the Spectrum.
Once more, the Islanders of the 1980s will take a stroll out for the ceremonial opening face-off as the members of the core of the four honored before the game, and I certainly hope you were with us for the entire hour-long pregame because it was something special. Clark Gillies, Brian Trottier, and even the Florida Panthers banging their sticks on the ice in appreciation of what this group of men did, and they're pretty well familiar with it because, don't forget, Dennis Potvin has been a longtime broadcaster for the Florida Panthers, so you know he is more than willing and able to regale them with stories of what it was like on Long Island during that very special time. And you see Clark Gillies and Brian Trottier in the center of your picture. There is Bill Guerin and Ole Jokinen lean in for the ceremonial faceoff. And let's see how Clarky drops the puck just about as perfectly as you would expect.
Nice and flat. Ole Jokinen obviously familiar a little bit with the Islander organization as well.
Having played a year here before being sent to the Panthers. And now we were saying before, Billy, players will tell you that when they win a championship, the bond with those teammates lasts forever. And that is very much the case with the crew that we've seen here today.
You just go through so many trials. You go through so many battles. That makes it a special experience. Your teammates with a lot of guys, but the ones that you win with makes it even that much better.
FSN New York and the New York Islanders are pleased to announce that today's game is being broadcast in Mandarin Chinese. To listen to that broadcast, go to the audio setup menu.
Very proud to present you the Conn Smythe Trophy. You really deserved it. And I know it's a team award, but you really led this team to this victory against an excellent hockey team, the Edmonton Oilers.
Thank you very much, and all I gotta say is there's probably a lot of people back in Canada that'll be turning over in their bed with me winning this tonight.
No, not at all. Not at all.
Oh, boy, that's about as colorful a Geico quote book as we could deliver. And really, Billy, that's only about half of it, because then he went on to talk about his Prestige fires.
One of the great interviews. So, one of the great Stanley Cup interviews of all time.
Remember when Smitty was accused of, well, not accused of, he did whack some guys in the legs with his stick with that sweep check, but, you know, he felt that the Edmonton Oilers,
some guys,
Gretzky and Anderson, took a few liberties in terms of leaving their feet. And he said, Anderson went down like a sniper got him. And I just want to let you all know that two can play that game. There is the captain of the four-time Stanley Cup winners, Dennis Potvin, who fiercely defends the notion that that was, in his words, the greatest team that's ever skated. He was part of the pregame ceremonies. Make sure to stay tuned for the Hockey Night Live intermission report presented by Geico at the end of the first period when we look back on what was a wondrous hour here at the Nassau Coliseum, and a lot of the guys in a big suite enjoying the proceedings in-game. And I sure hope you were with us before the game. And Chatan fires a save.
From the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, and the O's, Jiggs McDonald's broadcasting
not enough O's on the check your damn time.
Five decades. Well, you got the 10s to consider, too. You stick with us till 2010.
Oh, mercy.
What sticks out for you this afternoon? We're going to look back at the ceremony, beginning with the Walk of Fame, which was a tradition started a couple of years ago. They walked like champions in the 70s and 80s. Mm-hmm. Walking over on the Walk of Champions today, what sticks out for you from the ceremony today?
I think just the personality. There wasn't a bad apple, if you will. There wasn't there were a lot of different characters, but there was nobody ever out of control, nobody that you didn't want to be associated with or around. And that man, Al Arbour, was the reason. Everybody was kept under control, even the broadcaster staff, by Alger, because if you got out of line, Alger had a way of getting you aside and just letting you know he wouldn't tolerate that. Just a wonderful group of guys. And then, of course, the walk across, the red carpet. It's a much it's got to be the way Paul Newman felt, or any movie actor or actress going to a premiere, because the crowd yelling your name, and it's like, I didn't score a goal. I never put the skates on. But guilty by association.
So Al Arbour knew exactly what worked, though, with each of his players, good and bad, positive and negative.
I used this term this morning. He was a sports psychologist before we'd ever heard that. Nobody had a sports psychologist on staff, but Al
knew. Now we need broadcasting psychologists.
Al knew what buttons to push. He knew if a player wasn't feeling well, if a player had relatives in from Western Canada or Eastern Canada, if they were spending too much time in the restaurants or in the city, if hockey wasn't number one, if there was a sick baby at home, this kind of thing. He just knew exactly what was going on with his team at all times.
And the fact that John Tonelli said it to us as well tonight, that each one of the guys had their moment. When someone needed when they needed a goal to be scored, mm-hmm. a big hit delivered, a great save, every single one of the players, the 16, the core, the four, contributed at their time. They all had their moment.
Bobby Nystrom has told a story, Deb. In that fifth game in the best of five series against Pittsburgh, they're down 3-1 at home. He's in the penalty box, and the penalty timekeeper said, you know, I just can't believe it's going to end like this. Bobby said, it isn't over. We'll win.
It just goes to show you, he still remembers the story about the guy in the penalty box who may have helped them win because he was so mad that someone had said it might be over.
It wasn't going to be over, and it could have been. Mike Bullard had an opportunity in overtime, Deb. He's all alone. He's open, going down the right side. The puck jumped over to stick. Islanders come back the other way. It was just...
Wasn't Randy Carlyle, the Ducks coach, involved in a play that almost went the other way?
Yes, he was. He was very definitely involved. And
in the John Tonelli tying goal, just that could have changed the course of history. We talk about Bobby Nystrom's goal changing the fortunes of mm-hmm. the Islander franchise. You know, the bounce of a puck going one way or the other, that could have prevented four straight, or the Islanders may never have gotten started.
Exactly. The Rangers were a good hockey team, and the Islanders found a way to blow through them. And a couple of the guys have said that 1983 series, sweeping the Edmonton Oilers, who were obviously the heir apparents. They had the run-and-gun style. They had certainly number 99 and Mr. Gretzky setting records for the number of points scored in a season. To hold him off the scoreboard. And, of course, Smitty made sure he held him away from the net, too, with that little tap on the chin pads.
He had 196 points, Wayne Gretzky, during that regular season, and not a single point in the Stanley Cup Finals. Just amazing. Of course, the Oilers had their year the next year. And for the Islanders, it's about... For more information, 1-800-882-ILES. And we thank Jiggs.
You're welcome.
For
Deb, anytime.
His long years of service, but we'll have you back. We'll put you back to work before you know it.
Well, there's the old guy. And Mrs. McGee.
Walking the red carpet, what were you wearing? Who were you wearing?
You mean the cologne?
Deep and making something happen. So, as the jerseys of legends hang in the room, the highlights of the first period were brought to you by Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% on car insurance. Visit them at geico.com or call 1-800-947-AUTO. Second.